Hi, everybody. I'm Molly Wood, as Jesse just introduced me as. Thanks for having me tonight. It's actually my second Narrow Chimney Reading, and I'm really grateful and really flattered to have the opportunity to come back. I actually kind of tried to back out a couple of weeks ago. I was talking to Jesse, and I was like, I just don't want to do it. Like, I've just been writing all of this, terrible, tortured, broken-hearted love poetry. And he was like, you have to do it anyway. He was like, I'm not giving you the option. You can't back out. Which is good. I mean, it's nice, and it's encouraging, and I feel like it's important for artists to share their work regardless of the subject matter. I'm gonna, like I said, share some tortured, broken-hearted love poetry that I feel like I probably should have gone through when I was, 17 or something like that, but I didn't decide or have my heart broken until about a year ago-ish. So we're gonna go through that, and you're gonna go through it with me, and I'm gonna get more sunny as the evening goes on. I read a lot of really short poems, so I hope that's okay. I feel like one of the biggest complaints with my work is that it's too short, which is really strange to me because I'm really into short poems, which is maybe because I have a really short attention span. And even the prose that I write is very short. So I'm gonna do a lot of poems or a few poems, and then if I have time, I'm gonna do a really, really short piece of prose thereafter. And my first one is called A Concise Letter to Cupid. Dear Cupid, go fuck yourself. I hope your arrows give you splinters. I hope the string breaks on your bow, ricochets back, and hits you in the eye. I hope you accidentally shoot yourself in the foot and fall in love with a mannequin, you saucy little bastard. Thank you. The next one's called Salt. And we grow to find the diamonds promised to us in our champagne glasses are actually comprised not of carbon, but sodium chloride. The love that was supposed to intoxicate and endure has dissolved, and when met by lips and mixed with saliva, is spit back out onto the facade of a five-star table. We are left thirsty. Iodine flat sparkling wine and the promises dissolve. We find our gold rings are for fools, made of pyrite. Unfulfilled promises, fairy tales that turned out to be a fly's buzz, no tale to fly away with, no portal into romantic grown-up bliss, but just this. Long days and short nights, short kisses and long fights. What seemed so real and tangible is revealed to be a hologram. We reach for fingers that our hands slip through, and we end up hugging ourselves alone. Eventually, the electricity goes out, and even the hologram disappears. Memories linger and act as torture chambers. We strap ourselves to the mind stretching board and find we can endure an impressive amount of pain and still not die, though we've been completely torn apart. And then things got better. This one is On Freedom by a Former Vagabond. Sorry, that was an uncalculated timing for me drinking beer. This is On Freedom by a Former Vagabond. Freedom isn't being able to drive 110 miles per hour. It isn't leaving. In fact, as far as I can tell, freedom doesn't really involve freeways at all. As far as I can see, freedom is actually having the lucidity to turn whatever nightmare life might seem to be back into a dream. Freedom is taking responsibility, taking the scapegoats off of their leashes. Cages and chains are made for those victim mindsets. If we take our hands off the wheel, the texture of the road determines our route. Don't let this be your fate. Instead, we choose to participate and grab the wheel, and we take ourselves somewhere. Thank you. I don't even remember picking these poems to read. It's kind of like a surprise every time I come up on the new one. This next one is called Hardened Hearts Paved with Sorrow, which isn't as depressing as it sounds. Flowers push through the flat rock and pavement as if to say, you can't keep us down, not with asphalt or concrete or gravel. Dragon snaff laugh at those attempts. Daisies bloom gracefully from the cracks. Ivy climbs our fence into the neighbor's yard. Even dirt pushes itself over the bricks, too much to sweep away. And this, apparently, is the beginning of forgetting. Thank you. Up next is Coyote Gods. I don't know, so Coyote is just a little backstory. I hate when people give backstories to their poems, but I do it sometimes anyway. So coyotes are symbols of mischief in most Native American cultures, I think especially the Navajo. So mischievous coyote gods. I have great things in store for you, said God with a sly smile smirked across his face, but you've defined them. And as he started to walk away, he looked over his slinking shoulder, smiled a devious, mischievous smile, and said, they're the farthest thing from what you'd expect. Take advantage of every opportunity, and even when you're tired or sad or broken, take advantage. And if staying home reading poems seems like an opportunity, then turn your cell phone off and let the leaves of pages fall around you. Don't beat yourself up in your solitude. All opportunities comprise the compass that will guide you home. He continued, learn which parts of yourself to listen to. Become intimate with your essence and learn her voice. Know the scent of her breath and the tickle of her hair on your neck while she whispers so close. Follow her when she beckons. Further develop intuition and you will always know her. Our essence exists in the fourth dimension, in the future and the past and the present, and she dwells in the clouds, a level above you, and from that view, sees far in distance and time. And if you listen, you can hear that, and it's time to dust your shoes off. Thank you. The next one is called Summer Cycles. Wine glasses like watermelons, a green stem filled with rosé, accumulated gnats act as seeds. It is summer. We lounge in the heat with cool booze for relief, and who can blame the bugs for wanting to join? A sweet, slow, slurred, stumbling, fluttered death they've happened upon. The sunset is like my watermelon wine glass, green trees, rosé-colored clouds, with a murder of crows soaring and screeching overhead. Like the gnats, I am inside of my own wine glass, drinking my way to my own demise. What a wonderful approach to death I've chosen. Slow, sweet, I stumble over a moment. Laying in the red dirt with box elder leaves above me, I look up, submerged in my situation, and inhale. The gnats take another gulp. Maybe this isn't so bad after all, they think. They bob on the wine's surface, and I float to the top of the cotton candy clouds and bask in my fate. Maybe this isn't so bad after all. I draw another intoxicating breath to the bottom of my lungs, and my exhale finds a new route to exit. I feel the air push out of my shoulder blades, sprouting wings which have been germinating for 26 years. Up in the clouds, I find a few friends. So I'm not the only one who's matured. So I'm not the only one whose exhale has found new routes to come through. I'm not the only one whose wings have hatched out of these shells that we call bodies. And I remember the watermelon I am inside of, and it's never been sweeter, and I've never had quite this much nectar to quench my thirst. Thank you. So we've got one more poem, I think. Do I have a lot of time left? Like, how much time left? I always feel like time slows down a little bit up here. Not because I'm nervous at all. 6 minutes? I've got 6 minutes? Okay, well, I'm not going to be able to fill that up. Unless I just talk for a really long time, which I can do, and I'm probably going to do that after I finish these poems. Because I think it was Oscar Wilde who said that his best poetry occurred in conversation, which is why I walk around with a typewriter, or a voice recorder. Not really. I'm not that narcissistic. I don't actually do that. Although sometimes I say things and I'm like, that's good. That was good. But I don't know if it really is. Anyway, my next poem is called Images. And it's short also. And here it is. There is a symphony of shapes in my summertime garden. Melodies of smells. Burning candle flames bursting out of green, purple, and blue lanterns illuminating the nightscape. Accentuating the unique shapes, free-moving leaves in the night's gentle breeze. How easy these nights are. A clear, warm sky sprayed with spots of stars. In the distance, Jupiter is chased by Mars, trying to get lucky, just like the rest of us. Thank you. This next one is untitled and without consequence. To my beloved bamboo plant sitting atop my bookcase, growing so dark, green, and leafy, stretching from a black, rock-filled mason jar, a subtle soapstone seahorse situated amongst your slithering roots. Oh, my love, my plant, let me say this. You are lucky I am not a panda bear. Thank you. So this is my one piece of prose that's really short and unedited. And it's about fall and winter, because summer's over. Officially. Unfortunately, the summer's over. I wrote this on August 27th. The morning hangs gently, like subtle swaying, almost silent wind chimes after a storm. There's fog on the windows, and water collects and surrenders to gravity. Tiny pools collect and reflect the sky's creamy gray. Fall is just starting to creep up the trunks of the trees. It is like they are putting on their makeup, getting all gussied up before winter slinks in and seduces them out of their leaves, decorating the streets and gutters with their discarded clothing. The trees smell winter first. The sweetness of her perfume, the natural musk of her body, and everyone starts blushing. Except the grumpy, chaste evergreens who serve as the monks of the forest. Her scent precedes the sounds of her footsteps, which are reminiscent of flocks of birds taking flight for the first time in 6 months. Then she appears. Eyes burn with winter's fire, for fire is the only fruit of winter. Her hips sway from an hourglass waist, and she wears a long white dress with a slit up the left leg. The fabric elegantly caresses her curves and crevices, collarbone accentuated by a thin silver chain. She saunters through the trees. Her skin like honey cream. Once she's arrived and the last leaf has vulnerably quivered off the shyest twig, she makes a show of stepping out of her white dress. All the while being so gentle and quiet. And then the forest is covered in her whiteness, her snow. And only the earthworms know what kind of love is made beneath her white sheet. Thank you.